So this will be recorded. You're welcome to drop any questions into the chat at any time. There will be several checkpoints throughout the presentation that I will check in on the questions and get started. Before we get started, can everyone hear me okay and see the slides? Okay, great. This morning, I sent you a handout that will go along with this presentation. It has several of the questions that we'll be exploring today, as well as some helpful links. It does look like some of those links aren't working correctly, so I will send out a corrected handout to you after the presentation is over. Sorry about that. It looks like I possibly included the private links instead of the external share links for you. All of the guides links are also always available through our RIMS website, which you can find at go.uillinois.edu/RIMS. And they're also linked throughout this presentation on the slides, and those links should be correct. You'll also receive a copy of this presentation slides later. So let me introduce myself and my unit. My name is Julie Wagner. I am the RIMS coordinator with the Records and Information Management Services team with the System Office of the University of Illinois. I've been at the university almost 3 years now. Before I came up to Illinois, I lived in Austin, Texas, and I worked at the State Library and Archives Commission and also Health and Human Services down there. I have my master's degree in Library and Information Sciences from the University of North Texas. So a lot of you are familiar names, so you've possibly worked with us before, but if you haven't, our Records and Information Management Services team, which you'll often see shortened to RIMS, we serve all three universities and system offices. We currently have 6 people on our team. 4 of us are based in Urbana and 2 in Chicago. We also usually have 2 or 3 grad students, usually from the iSchool, but they could be from anywhere, working with us on different projects. I personally oversee grad students who do a lot of inventory and appraisal work, but we also have grad students working on other projects like our email recognition project. We are your go-to source for any records management questions that you may have. You'll find our website and the knowledge base is full of helpful guides and worksheets and just general information about helping you manage your records better, all of the retention schedules, plus information about how to dispose of your records. And it's important for you to remember that you don't have to do any of this alone. We're always happy to help. And right now we're all working remotely, but in typical circumstances, we are available to come visit your office and consult on your files, usually very quickly after you contact us. We're also willing to get creative with you during these kind of tough times. We can do a lot through screen sharing and other phone calls and emails and such. So don't feel afraid to reach out at any time. I've included my email address, but you can also contact the General RIMS team through our website. Today, we're going to be talking in particular about records inventory and documentation. This webinar is scheduled for 2 hours, but I anticipate being able to give you back some of that time into your day. We should still have plenty of time for questions and everything. Like I said just a second ago, there are several checkpoints along the way where we will pause. I'll answer any questions that have come up into the chat. Sometimes if you have a very particular question that is unique to your department or situation, I might ask you to email me instead so we can speak in depth about it outside of this meeting so that we don't hash it out live during this presentation and kind of hold it up. But in general, I'd love to answer your questions and I'll just save them for certain points in the webinar. Our agenda today, first, we're going to touch very briefly on some basic concepts of records management just to get you oriented. Then we'll head straight into how to plan and prepare an inventory. Next, we'll talk about the actual nuts and bolts of conducting an inventory. And finally, we'll talk about how to put your results to work and some next steps to take. Throughout the presentation, there will be links included on the slides. Those should all be updated and work for you, but I will also have them included on the updated handout that I send to you later. So you don't have to worry about bookmarking all of those throughout the presentation. They're just there for reference. All right, so before we really plunge into the deep end, let's go over a quick summary of some basic terms and concepts of records management. So one of the most important questions that you ask yourself during inventory or just in your general day-to-day office life, is it a record or is it not? So records are the original master version of a file that is created or received by your office, and your office is considered the responsible office of record. Usually you'll know if your office is the office of record, but if you don't know, you can always ask RIMS and we can help figure that out for you. Sometimes it can be a complicated kind of structure, especially with HR records or something else that flows upwards to other offices. So we can definitely help you investigate that process. Convenience copies are the files that are in your office for business convenience, but your office is not considered the office of record. So if you have a report that's filed up the chain of command, your copy might not be considered the original copy, but the submitted report would be considered it. We're always happy to discuss the nuances there. We can help you figure it out. There's also a instructional training video that I have that is much expanded on the topic that's available through our website as well. And then at the bottom of this slide, you can also see a link to a flow chart of is it a record. There's also a lot of written guidance at that document as well. So you can read up on your on is it a record or not, if that's how you prefer to learn. Second, some of the most important stuff that RIMS does, we publish and update the records retention schedules for the entire university. Your office may have an older records retention schedule that predates RIMS. If so, let us know. We'd like to look over it and work with you on getting it updated and getting your office in line with all of our newer guidance. RIMS isn't really that old in the grand scheme of things. So definitely if your office hasn't really dealt with records management in several years, you probably have some older schedules or older guidance, and we'd love to help get you updated. And then finally, if you're not sure where a file would fit on your records retention schedule, or if you just like don't know where to even start with the retention schedules, they can be overwhelming. Just remember that it's really just a listing of file types. So you're looking for file types and you're looking for like a generalized category that your file can fit into. And then it will tell you how long you should legally be keeping that file. And if you ever need help finding something, just contact us at RIMS. We are always happy to help with that. And we can also usually tell you within a minute or two where to find that file, because we work with these schedules every day and we know that you don't. So we're happy to be your experts there. Before we really plunge into the deep end, I just want to remind you to try not to be overwhelmed today. The ideas and processes that we're going over are the ideal, really detailed processes. But they may not be your reality, and that's fine. You can use all of these ideas as a starting point and then adjust it for your real life office situation. All right, so let's go over some ways that you can get ready for an inventory before it starts. Planning ahead is the best way to make sure that the process goes smoothly. Let's talk about what is a records inventory. So a records inventory at its most basic decides what records are used and created by your office, where the records are stored, the volume of records, the condition of the records, and it identifies areas of your office that might need to be purged or moved. So not all inventories are created equal, and you're going to be able to customize your inventory to capture the information that your office really needs to function and go forward with whatever action you want to take from your inventory. So where should you start? Well, let's talk first about what your motivation is for starting an inventory or being interested in doing a records inventory. A lot of people start because they want to do a retention review. You want to make sure your files are kept properly and disposed of on schedule. And maybe you suspect that a lot of the files that are kept in your shared drive in your office are over retention and can probably be disposed of. An inventory is a great place to start to identify those files. And one of the most common reasons that we are contacted about inventories is that you need more space. Maybe you're running out of storage space, either physical or electronic. But how do you choose what stays and what goes? Well, your inventory will help you with that by telling you what files are actively being used, what files are over retention, and all of those things that can help go into your decision-making process about what can go and what can stay. Maybe you just want to get organized. Maybe your office has tons of different filing systems, inconsistent methods, or you just can't find anything in your office, and no one has ever really documented where stuff goes and how it's filed. So we can also help you get organized through an inventory. Exploratory. This can be kind of like your surprise stash of files in the basement that you didn't know existed until someone retired, or just any kind of like files that you're not sure what is in that filing cabinet or what's in that share drive and you need to do something to figure it out. An inventory can really help you explore those files in a structured way. Merging and moving, your office is maybe on the move or consolidating with another unit, and you need to know exactly where everything is going. It can really help if you map and inventory your records so that you can keep clear what is going and what is going to offsite storage, what's going to your new office, et cetera, et cetera. And then just catch all other life happens, all sorts of things can force an inventory, and you tell us what's going on. I am going to launch a poll because I'd like to hear from you guys what you think are your motivations for getting an inventory going. Hopefully that poll should now be available to you. Do you guys see it? Okay, great. Okay, so I'm seeing a lot of people who want to get organized, about 56% of you guys, and then an even split between retention review, needing more space, and merging and moving, and then only about 10% of you wanting to do something exploratory. So that's a pretty normal split that I would expect. You know, a lot of people want to get more organized and also document their processes around organization within their office, but you just don't know exactly where to get started or how to get people on board. We are gonna talk more about that later. And the retention review is just a very normal office process especially if no one has really done it in a while. Those retentions change over time, they get updated. It's very normal to have to review that. And I mean, everyone always needs more space, especially with your physical files. We understand that space is a finite resource. And even with your shared drive, it may seem like it's infinite, but that storage does cost money. And the more files that you have on your shared drive, the harder it is to retrieve your files because you've got more stuff to look through. So it's great to purge that shared drive on an annual or some kind of regular basis as well. And your inventory can help you do that. All right, did we have any questions before I continue? All right, I'm not seeing anything in the chat, so I'm gonna go ahead and continue. But if you do have a question that comes up, or maybe you're still typing, I will get to it. So don't worry, you can drop it in there at any time. All right, so on a surface level, the process of a records inventory is very simple. First, you map out the areas that you're going to be looking at. Then identify the places that you'd like to start. Next, you'll review your files and document what you find. And then finally, after you've finished your inventory, you will compile your results and analyze what to do next. What you do with your results depends on what your motivation is. And we'll talk more about that later. But first, remember that your reality is always different than this ideal that we're talking about. You don't have to do everything all at once. You don't even have to do everything, period. Do what works best for you and your situation. We really recommend breaking this project into phases by thinking about areas to focus on first. It's really overwhelming to do an inventory that's every single file and type in your office. So focus on smaller areas and get an area done and then move on to the next. That might be a room, it might be a filing cabinet, it might be a type of file. However, you want to break up the project, but we really recommend trying to break it up into different phases like that. And then we're going to talk about this more right now, but determine what information you want to collect before you begin. So don't just plunge right in without the plan of what you want to collect. And really put some thought into the information that you are collecting so that you're not doing more work than you need to. So let's think about what you really need to know from your inventory. A really important thing to know is your file type. What kind of file are you looking at? Is it an employment verification? Is it a receipt? Is it a draft of a report? If it's electronic, what format is it stored in? That's one of the most basic things that you can have for a record. Dates associated, depending on the type of record, you might need to document either the date created, date completed, or the date that it's eligible for disposal. And that will be based on the retention period. How long you should keep that record. Is it a record or is it just a copy? That's where that question comes into play. This will help you dispose of your records on a more consistent schedule and keep you from hoarding things in your office. And like I said earlier, retention schedules do change. They're updated every couple of years. We've got different kind of guidance. Certain records have the marking for archival review. So if you are going through and matching retention periods to your records, make sure to make a note of anything that's flagged for archival review, because before you dispose of that record, we will need to consult with the university archivist. Volume of records, this can be a guesstimate or exact to the millimeter, whatever works best for you. You can put down 2 drawers, 5 inches, 1 gigabyte, whatever is most helpful for you. Some people think in terms of exact inches of records, and some people kind of think more of like, oh, it's about two drawers of records, or, you know, it's about one filing cabinet of records. Whatever works best for you. The volume is really just to tell you, to get you familiar with how much space you're using for your records. It can be surprising when you put it down on paper, because sometimes it looks like a lot more than it actually is, or vice versa. Condition. You don't always need to note this, but sometimes it's good to know, are your paper records dry and safe? Are they wet, possibly moldy? And are your electronic files backed up properly? Where are they backed up? How are they backed up? Are you sure? That sort of thing. And condition, you know, it's more important for your really long-term records than it is for your shorter-term records. A short-term record is considered maybe 5 to 10 years retention. And then a longer-term record is something with something longer than 10 years. Condition is more important for those longer-term records because we do want them to last. And if you ever need consulting on the condition of your records, maybe you just like don't really know what the signs of mold are or signs of insect activity, we can also help with that. And that's part of our regular consulting services. Location is really important to document, whether it be a file path or a drawer location, you should be documenting it on your inventory. We're going to talk a little bit about file maps in a minute, but this is a great place to make note of how the files are organized as well. So you can say it's located in a file cabinet 3 and it's organized by alphanumerical order, all in the location file. Or you can just include the file path if it's an electronic inventory. And then finally, status. How often do you use it? Is it an active record that you still reference regularly, or is it inactive and rarely referenced? This can determine whether or not you can move it to offsite storage or just move it to a different folder that is out of the way of your more active files so that you can access your active files more quickly. And the definition of regularly is really up to your interpretation. I would suggest going with something that maybe like, do you pull it out and reference it once a month, or do you pull it out and reference it once a year? That could change how you file it and where you file it. But again, up to you and your business needs there. Other things that you can consider making on your inventory are access and security status of the file, who has access to the files, what level of access each person in the office should have, and that sort of thing. So if you have files that are highly confidential, make a note of who has the keys to the filing cabinet or who has permission to the shared folder. And also, it's a good time in your inventory to review who has credentials to access your shared folders, because a lot of times with shared drives, we end up sharing folders with people and then they leave employment or they go to a different unit and they still have access to our shared folders. So it's really important to review those access credentials on a regular basis, and your inventory is a good place to do that. Historical importance to your office or the university at large could be a question that you need to answer. Sometimes a record has a retention period of, say, 10 years, and it's eligible for disposal, but you consider it an important record because Maybe it has a lot to do with the creation of your department. Maybe it's a really important event that was a landmark for your unit, that sort of thing. If it has historical importance to your unit, you're always welcome to keep it in your unit. If you think it has a historical importance to the university at large, we can work with you to assess the record and also be a liaison to the archives for you. If you don't know and you don't think that you can make the decision about what it is, or maybe on the retention schedule it's marked as needing archival appraisal, you can also contact RIMS and we can come consult on those records for you. And we are happy to act as a link to the archives and get that all set up for you. Most importantly, before you start your inventory and before you create your inventory form, really consider what information is a business necessity right now. So what information do you absolutely need to collect and what information is just kind of nice to know? Consider these things before you make your inventory form because it will affect how efficient your inventory goes. Because the more information you collect, the slower the inventory will go. So just make sure that you're only collecting information that is a business necessity. And remember that once your first inventory is done, it's much easier to go back and add details later if you need them. You don't always need all of these like nitty-gritty details though. Sometimes you just need the file type and inclusive dates and volume, and that's it. But sometimes you also maybe need to know the access and security for each of the files or whether or not they're in good condition. And you can add those on as needed, but start with the essentials and then move on to the details afterwards. So I encourage you to use one of the examples that I'm about to show you as a starting point and create a form that uniquely addresses your office's needs. So our RIMS inventory template is designed for you requesting a disposal of your records. So it is kind of a very basic inventory sheet. And then I'm going to show you a more in-depth detailed inventory that one of my students did for a client. And again, just a reminder, you don't need to collect everything, just what's necessary. So this is the standard RIMS inventory template that you can download from our website or at this box link below. As you can see, it's very basic. You have your object identifier, which is location. It's the box, drawer, folder where it is located. And this is just meaningful to you and not necessarily us. It should be a location that anyone in your office should be able to recognize. So if it does say box 5, the box should be labeled externally box 5, or if it's a filing cabinet 2, the filing cabinet should have that number on it, and you should also have a map of your office that has those filing cabinets identified as well, and we're going to have examples of maps later in the presentation. Description, description can be just like the file type, so you can put employment records or receipts, T-card, whatever you want in the description, the file type goes there, and any other notes that you need for yourself to know what they are. And then you've got date range, so usually we encourage at the very least the final date that is associated with the record. But preferred the entire date range when the record was created to when it became inactive. volume, again, this can be a guesstimate, but as close to precise as you can get, but don't worry about getting it down to like the exact level or measurement. Notes is just a free-for-all field for you, for any kind of reference notes that you need on those records. Okay, this is an example of a more detailed inventory that one of my grad students did. The reason that it's more detailed is we were actually preparing these files for an archival transfer. So most records inventories that you guys are doing are probably not going to be at this level, just because you don't necessarily need a folder level inventory for every single drawer of your filing cabinet. You can just go with like a high level, like these are subject files. But for transfer to the archives, we do need a folder level inventory. So you can see we've got the cabinet location as well as cabinet drawer, which we later converted into box numbers as we moved the stuff out of the cabinets into boxes. So we added another column basically that said box number, and we had all those boxes neatly labeled. And you'll see that when we switched drawers from 3 to 4, she also listed what the drawer title was, so Historic Illinois Politics. And then we've got the date range of the folders, and this is kind of just like at a glance, you look through the folder and see what dates you see. Those are usually the dates we go with. And then the folder title. And then if it has a subfolder within a folder, we would do a detail on the folder. Again, this is a very detailed inventory, and you probably will not be going to this level of detail. But just in case you wanted to see what that would look like, I wanted to include this example. Just a reminder, start by doing what's necessary, then what's possible, and suddenly you're doing the impossible. A motivational quote for you all. All right, let's go. Do we have any questions actually before we move on? Okay, I'm not seeing anything in the chat, so I will go ahead and move on. Let's talk about conducting an actual inventory. So again, looking at our process, easy on paper, maybe not so easy in reality. So when we're talking about file maps, what you want is a high level visual summary of your records. You wanna visualize your organizational system. And it will help you look at how your space is utilized and how things might overlap and maybe some efficiencies within your organization that you can clean up by reorganizing your files. It'll also help you make note of your location and folder hierarchy, especially for your shared drive. So let's look at an example of how this could look. So for your shared drive, we have the system up here at top, which is Dropbox in this example. And your first layer of folders are going to be related to the core functions of your office. So for example, RIMS has retention schedules, outreach, administrative, and a couple of other folders on this level. And these are like the most basic broad functions of your office. And then the next layer is gonna be within that broad function. So if folder one is outreach, then the two subfolders that I have underneath that folder at the next level are going to be our newsletter, our training, any website content, and articles that we publish, that sort of thing. And then, you know, administrative would be more like our meeting notes and agendas, materials that we have internally, like contact info for staff, that sort of thing. And your third level, which is that yellow level, is going to be hopefully your last folder level. And it will just break apart however you want to organize that function of subfolder three. So for example, if this was our newsletter folder, the orange subfolder would probably be by fiscal year, so that we can at a glance see what newsletter we published in FY19, FY20. This will also later make it easy so that we can dispose of those files by folder instead of just individually letting them hang out. A lot of people don't really do a regular review and disposition of their shared drive, but including date indicators in the names of all your files will help you organize the files better so that you can go back and do those regular purging of your files and really getting your shared drive clean and efficient. So this is an example from the New York State Archives of what an office file plan or file map would look like. So this is your actual physical space as compared to your electronic space, a little bit different. But as you can see, they've numbered all of their filing cabinets. So on your inventory sheet, which we'll return to, you can then say file cabinet two, and someone can reference this file map and find file cabinet two within seconds. And it really helps to have both the map and the labels on the filing cabinets, and make sure that the map is available to your employees and they know where it is at all times. And I'll go over some tips for that as well. So once you've made a visual map, you can really start to revisit your motivation for starting the inventory. So if you keep your motivation in mind, think about it for a minute as we talk about prioritizing your inventory process. It's important to set your priorities for any project, but especially something overwhelming like inventory, because if you just start wherever, you and your team won't have the same purpose that you will if you have more immediate short-term goals in mind. So think about what your pain points are in your office. Looking at your file map, what areas of the office or shared drive cause the most headache within your office? What isn't working? And then flag these projects as priorities. Do you have an urgent need to move or reduce your footprint? Sometimes these projects can be knocked out more quickly than you think if you have a lot of records that are past retention and can be destroyed without extensive inventory. It is important to keep in mind that because of state law, we have to request that permission to destroy your records, and that can take up to a month to receive that permission. So plan ahead at least a month in advance before you have to actually dispose of things, so that we can have that go smoothly for you. And if none of those priorities resonate with you, you can think about getting the most bang for your buck with where you start. So you can choose an area of the office that you suspect has many files past your attention and start identifying all the files you can request permission to destroy, or you can spend a few hours cleaning up the organization within one specific folder in your shared drive by standardizing file names and date formats. So, who's on your team? Make sure to get your unit leadership on board and on the same page with your priorities. Make sure there aren't any curveballs in your future by having the conversation early and communicating your progress regularly. Beyond leadership, it's often overlooked that if you're doing a big inventory process that might involve moving records around, updating your organizational systems, or even just you being away from your desk for a couple hours a week, make sure you let your colleagues know what you're doing and listen to any concerns that they have. We'll talk a little bit more about this later, but I always encourage you to ask for feedback from your colleagues and really communicate what you're doing with them as well. And then I recommend that you recruit at least one other person to be kind of a co-conspirator on this inventory, because it's helpful to both share the load and also make sure that your plans are coherent and will make sense to other people. And it's always best to bounce that off another person. Some time-saving strategies for your inventory. It's good to remember that the more information you try to collect, the longer it will take. So keep it as high level as you can by collecting only necessary information. You can always go back and get those details later. If it's over retention, don't linger on the files there. So if you've identified it as past its retention, you don't need to go through those files and look through everything. You can request disposal and then we can help you get that process going for disposal. If you do believe they need to be evaluated for archival value, contact RIMS and we'll come do a consult for you. But generally, let the retention schedule guide you here. And if you see an entire drawer of files that are over retention, mark to destroy and move on as quickly as possible. You don't need to get in the weeds about those files. So resist the urge to snoop through them and move on. And then again, remember to talk to your team, keep them updated, especially if you're planning on moving things around. If they don't know that you're moving things, they might get frustrated with the whole process and kind of torpedo it before you even really started. They could possibly even undo the work by moving things back where they think they belong. So make sure that you're giving regular progress reports and letting people know if something is kind of under construction. If something isn't broken, you don't need to change it, but you can improve retrieval time by writing down how the system works and then saving that documentation in an easily findable place. For example, you can include a note of the organization at the beginning of a drawer, just on like a single page printout. You can tell people how the files are organized and any notes you have. Or if it's electronic, you can include it in the notes field of the encompassing folder. Just make sure to tell your team where they can find that sort of thing. And remember that filing systems shouldn't be a secret code that your colleagues have to crack individually. It should be something that you all share and commiserate about and help enforce it amongst your team. So, before you start, what is the ideal end result of your inventory? Keep that in mind as you move forward, as it will guide your decisions. So dedicate time and staff. A project that doesn't have dedicated time blocks will drag on forever. Even if you spare only 1 hour a week, block it into your calendar and commit to it. If multiple people are conducting the inventory, make sure that they're communicating so no work is duplicated or undone. Clearly mark any folders or drawers that are under construction, especially if you need to stop midway through so that no one will come along and undo your work. Interview your colleagues. Remember, you never know until you ask. Your colleagues might know what those files in the basement are. They might be able to crack the code of someone's old filing system. They might even know secret locations of even more files. and you won't know until you ask them. It's a great policy to also make a habit of interviewing any colleagues who are retiring or leaving your office after a long time. Make sure to write down any new information you receive and check to see if it's included in your documentation. All right, so let's inventory. It's finally time for you to dig into those files or that shared drive. Are you ready? So looking at our inventory template again, this is the time when you're actually filling out this inventory. And it's good to have at least two people doing it, although one person can do it, but just keep your team small and contained so that it's consistent across everyone how they're doing it, and communicate how you would like things documented. And again, you can get as detailed as you want, but just remember that the more detail that you want to include in your inventory, the slower it will go. And most importantly, if you want to make an easy job seem mighty hard, just keep putting off doing it. So the best thing you can do for yourself is get started and focus on a small area first. All right, so after you've completed that inventory template and you've gone through all the files in your first area, what do you do next? So I totally get it. It's one thing to do the inventory and go through all the files, and it's a totally different thing to use that inventory to drive a positive change within your department. So first things first, take your inventory and make sure that you've matched up all the retentions that you can. Request permission to dispose of any records that have met their retention, and flag any records that you think need archival appraisal. And then once you get that approval or that consultation, actually throw the files away and just totally get rid of them. Don't bother with them further. And if they do need archival appraisal and the archivist wants them, RIMS will work with you to help move those files and get them prepared for the archives as well. But it's important to do kind of a first cut on your files to get all of the excess stuff out and only deal with the files that actually are going to be active within your office and are still waiting to meet their retention. Next, consider your options for the remaining records. So inactive files that you don't reference very often can be sent to storage. You might have departmental storage that you have access to. You definitely have access to RIMS offsite storage, which is provided free to any department at any of the universities. And then you always have the option for third-party storage as well, although that usually comes with a price tag. But just remember that you have options for sending those inactive files to different locations other than your actual office. And if you need help with electronic storage, AITS is happy to help you figure out how we can help support your shared drive needs or your electronic storage needs. And finally, we want to document all of your choices as you make these decisions. It should become a habit to record everything you're doing with your records. Use your inventory to also record the decision, whether or not you disposed of it, if you moved it to offsite storage and where that offsite storage is, if you transferred it to the archives. Keep a record of it so that you know where your records are going. And finally, keep your inventory saved. Keep another document of your conclusions and findings and those actions that you're taking. And now we will talk about organizing your files. So getting organized is one of the main motivations that you guys talked about or that you guys identified in that poll earlier. we totally understand that an inventory is the first, the starting point of getting organized for a lot of people. A lot of these tips are focused mainly on electronic files and shared drive tips, but I think that they're all easily converted to tips for your regular physical files as well. Good record keeping can cross that divide really easily. And remember that the hard part is getting your files organized, but once you have that system set up, maintenance is much easier. Different types of filing systems: alphabetical, chronological, subject, area, numerical, any combination of those. Hopefully all of your files will follow some sort of filing system there. RIMS does have some guidance that I've linked below that you can read further on different filing systems. We're also going to talk about naming conventions. We recommend that you keep your naming conventions short and meaningful, that it always includes a date, whether that date be the creation date or the date is the final date associated with the document. It can even be the date that the file is eligible for disposal. Just make sure that you make a note somewhere publicly what that date is, so that nobody has to do investigative work later. We also recommend that you have a subject description. It includes a unit or project related, if that's applicable, and the state of the document, which would be draft, final version, etc. Of course, in these modern times on your shared drive, you also have the option of using the versioning feature, which can layer the documents on top of each other and allow you to access a history of all changes made, instead of having the multiple files like draft one, draft two, draft three. You can have just the one complete file that has a version history that you can access and reference at any time. And that's a great option for your files to keep them more efficient. So there's a lot more to naming conventions and how to do it successfully in this linked document here. But consistency is the most important thing, and then also just communicating your expectations and then enforcing the expectations. But I really encourage you to read that linked document. As far as folder structure, standardizing and maintaining a structured folder system for electronic files is going to ensure that your users can readily retrieve information that they need. And then it will also streamline your file purging process later as you set up a more regular disposal schedule, especially if you include those dates within the folder name, folder structure. You have a different folder for every fiscal year or calendar year. That can make disposition super easy because you can just dispose of the entire folder. Instead of going through individual files within the folder and figuring out which one can go and which one can stay. As much as possible, your unit should organize your shared folder structure areas according to your designated core activities, like we mentioned earlier, and in line with the unique types of work that are conducted by your unit. For example, a unit whose work is primarily project-based may need a folder structure that's primarily based on project titles. And a unit whose work is primarily report-based may need a folder structure primarily based on the reports that you produce. So I'm going to show you an example of the RIMS shared drive. So this is our top level of our shared drive. And you'll see we've got all of our core functions here. We've got administrative material, disposal, general reference that we provide, outreach, projects, retention schedules, storage. Those are the really broad categories of what RIMS does as a unit. And then when you drill down into one of the folders, you can see that within the folder, for example, I'm sharing the outreach folder with you. You can see that we've broken down the core functions within that particular function there. So the newsletter, presentation, social media, that sort of thing. Ideally, like we saw in that file map earlier, you want like 3 to 4 layers of folders, but the more complex your office is, the more layers you might need to have everything really organized. And that's okay. Just make sure that you're including kind of like scope notes and instructions for how things are filed and that sort of thing. So in order to do this, update your folder map regularly and share it with your employees. Make sure that they know where it is. So keep it in a really a place where everyone can access it at any time. Schedule regular intervals at which to review it to keep it as up-to-date as possible. Your share drive might change a lot, even over just a couple of months. So maybe you wanna update your map once every 3 months, once every 6 months, something like that. But just make sure to schedule it, and then it will be much easier going forward. And the more simple that you can make your folder structure, the more it's going to improve your retrieval times and make your office more efficient, because everyone will know at a glance where something is stored instead of having to click around. You can even add your notes for the file on the actual folder. If I just page back real quick, you'll see next to Outreach, there's a little I. So if you click that, you'll actually be able to access a note about that folder, and you can include what you expect to find in the folder and also any naming conventions that you want to include there. Okay, it's important that once you've done all the hard work to get your share drive into shape, you empower someone on your team to enforce the new system. This doesn't mean that you punish people that get it wrong or anything like that, but instead you have someone who's gonna gently notify them every time they misfile something or get a file name wrong. This can be especially tedious right at the beginning of a new system, but over time it will teach your team the new behavior more quickly than just pushing out the rules and hoping for the best. Again, it's best if this enforcement is done by just one or two people for consistency. And remember to keep your tone helpful and collaborative instead of combative. Change can be hard, and it will take time before your team is fully on the same page. To help them, you can create a cheat sheet of sorts to tell them at a glance how they're expected to name their files. So on that linked document from earlier about naming conventions, we explain what short and meaningful names will include. But on your cheat sheet, you can also standardize abbreviations and make sure people know how to abbreviate their unit and how to abbreviate certain common types of records and other expectations for your naming conventions there. And then during your transition to a new folder structure, you might find that a lot of folders are moving around to new file paths. And to help your employees learn where these are moving, beyond keeping the map as updated as possible, you can also include shortcut links that would bridge the old to the new. So for example, if my newsletter folder ended up moving to our administrative folder, instead of where it currently lives in our Outreach folder, I could put a shortcut link in the original location in Outreach that would take me to its new home in administrative materials, so that when I went to look for it, muscle memory in Outreach, I would be taken instead to its new home and reminded that it has moved to administrative materials. And over time, you'll be able to remove those shortcuts to clean up the share drive, but they can ease that transition a lot if you include them. And some more words of wisdom: for every minute spent in organizing, an hour is earned. Do we have any questions before I move on? Okay, I'm not seeing anything in the chat, so I'm gonna go ahead and go on. Let's talk about making all of your positive changes last within your office. So every change you make is only as good as the documentation that you make to support it. You wanna, it's your legacy. You wanna protect it. And your work shouldn't be wasted. So I recommend that you determine a records liaison within your unit. And to do this, I would recommend choosing a position within your unit. So say like administrative assistant, or even like if you want it to be like assistant director or someone like that, that can be your records liaison. But I think the key to ensuring that it continues beyond the person who is currently in that position is to make it part of their job description instead of just tied to a person. So you're not assigning records liaison duties to Margaret, you're assigning records liaison duties to assistant director. And then their job is to keep everyone on track with your filing systems, retention dates, storage locations. This should be the person that you empower with the authority to tell people when they've done something wrong and work with them on the new filing systems and make sure that all of the documentation that you're creating about the filing systems, about how to find things, your maps and everything are updated regularly. And this can also be the person who manages your regular records disposal and any kind of storage transfers that you need to make as well. And then we also recommend that you establish contact with RIMS. Maybe you just want to meet us and get a face-to-face meeting. Maybe you want to ask us about some of your records or explore how we can help you get started on a project. Any of that, we're happy to help. You can email us at any time through our website. And then we also want you to complete the records and administrative data management plan. I missed a word on that slide, but there's a management in between data and plan. And empower your records liaison to enforce the plan once you've written it down. So, and then before we talk more about the records plan, make sure that you always schedule your next inventory once you're finished with your first inventory. It will be easier the more you do it, because it's always easier to stay organized than to get organized. And it's up to you how frequently you do it. Once a year, once a semester, once a quarter. It really depends on how frequently you use your files, how much cleanup there needs to be done in between time periods. So you could start with a longer time period, like once a year, but maybe at the end of that year, when you go to do your new inventory, you find that a lot of things are misfiled and are disorganized again. So maybe you want to start doing your inventory once a semester instead, so you keep more on top of it. So it will depend on your individual office culture and also the nature of the files that you're working with. And you might need to do more frequent inventories for files that are more active. And then you can do less frequent inventories for the files that are not used as often, because of course they're not moving around, they're not being handled, so there's less to do there. So returning to the records and administrative data management plan, scary name, but easy plans, promise. This plan is a template that we have available to you that will hopefully help you pull all of your hard work on your inventory and your documentation all together into one place. It's basically a guided worksheet that's meant to help you document things like how your office functions, reporting lines within your office, security concerns, and then also putting your inventory to work by identifying your unit's most vital records. So those are the records that are most important to business continuity within your unit, as well as kind of asking you questions and getting to think about how your unit wants to handle scanning documents if you ever do that, and the purging of records and how you manage your disposition process. So after you've done an inventory, hopefully you can see that this pulling together of all your documentation will actually be really easy because you have all of the information that you need from your records inventory. This worksheet, what we call it the RADMAN for short, it's to help you consolidate and compile all of that information into one place that's for easy reference, and it can become an easy resource for your unit going forward that hopefully everyone can look at and understand. And you can adapt it as needed to your unit's needs. Again, like we're just providing you a template, you can make it whatever you need it to be. And we do want to let you know that we are working on a new records and administrative data management plan template. We want to eliminate the jargon in favor of simple, clear language. And we want to include more worksheets on specific records related topics that are a little more structured than what we have now. And we want to include our guidance on file naming and folder structure within the RADMAN and also help you brainstorm how to create file naming conventions that are specific to your unit within that RADMAN as well. So that's coming soon, hopefully. It's been in development for a while, but I have been derailed by everything that's been going on this year. So I'm a little behind schedule on getting that out, but we're really trying to put ourselves in kind of the everyday office worker's shoes with our new template and make the RADMAN as simple as possible to complete. So especially once you've completed your inventory, you've got that inventory sheet with all of your different files listed out, it should be really easy to complete. And you'll find that you know a lot more about your records than you thought you did with these kind of guided questions. And it'll be great for future people in your office to consult, and you can update it at any time. And we just want to encourage you to ask for help. Our team, the Records and Information Management Services team, we exist to help you with your records. We're here to support you in any way that you need support with your record keeping, your organization, your inventories, your shared drive, whatever you need. We're here to help, and we want to help. Not only do we offer consulting on all of those things, I also personally have usually two grad students that are available to help with inventories. We can customize that plan for you. There is sometimes a waiting list for when they're available, but if you kind of get on my radar as wanting a records inventory, I can get that scheduled. And don't forget that we also have free offsite storage for all the campuses, and maybe even more, because we're always looking to expand our services and help you in any way we can. So if you have a unique problem, let us know and we will try to help. So Angela has a question. Do you see more departments wanting to move to electronic records now that digital images are acceptable documentation? I think the answer is yes to that. A lot of people are switching over to born native electronic documents. And that's a great way to go, especially, you know, now we have university-wide guidance for guidance and support for Adobe Sign, which has electronic signatures. We do have some guidance available on our website about electronic records, the most stable ways to keep those. And we can also consult on individual departments and your situation as well if you want to reach out. As far as scanning goes, we typically try to discourage people from just scanning records for the sake of making them electronic, because we can keep them as physical and still reference them, especially if they're inactive files. You definitely don't need to scan them. You can just send them to offsite storage. And if you ever do need to reference them, we can pull those files for you. We have a lot of guidance on when and how to scan on our website available as well. But that's kind of a different topic. Any other questions before we move on? All right, I'm not seeing anything in the chat. So just so you're aware, we do have some self-paced training available whenever you want it. We encourage you to assign it to your staff so that they can kind of be more aware of records management. We call it Records Management 101. It's 4 videos that are available through YouTube. They're all about 5 minutes long and they cover really basic topics. Like the first one dives into what is a record and how do you know it's a record and really dives into that discussion. The second one is all about retention, how to read those retention schedules, how to get more comfortable with retention. The third one is filing systems and storage. So that's a lot of what we talked about today, but in kind of a short bite-sized video. And then module 4 is transfer and disposal of records, which is the disposition of records and how to properly dispose of your records or transfer them to the archives or whatever you need to do for your records. So those are always available for you on demand through our website. And we are looking to add more of those instructional videos in the future about more in-depth topics. And we're also looking to do future webinars about other topics as well. So if you have any suggestions for topics that you would want a deep dive webinar like this, please let me know. Or if you think that we could have another module that's more bite-sized information for someone, we're also looking to create more of those. And we're happy to get any feedback on those. So just a quick recap of everything we did today. Basic concepts of what is a record and how to access our retention schedules. Planning ahead, including prioritizing your inventory, visualizing all of your areas and making maps of what you're doing. And also starting your documentation and making note of all of the existing file plans that you have already. Number 3, actually conducting the inventory using your template and customizing it to your office so that you're collecting information that's important to you and not just everything that you can possibly collect. And then finally, we talked about how to get your office more organized and how to put your inventory to work by cleaning out your office of records that are past their retention, and also what to do with your active and inactive records and identifying your vital records within your office. So in addition to the handout that I emailed this morning, that I will send out a corrected handout with the actual correct links after this is over, you can also go to our website and find all of those handouts You can find links to our training, the retention schedules, all sorts of general reference about records management available on our website and on KnowledgeBase. So you can read for days information there. And then if you have any questions in particular about your unit, you're welcome to email me or go to our website and use the contact form there. And I'll get you connected. I'll either answer your question myself or I will connect you to someone else in RIMS who can answer your question in particular. So that's everything that I have for you guys today. I'm happy to answer any questions if you want to drop them in the chat. All right, I'm not seeing any questions in the chat, so you're welcome to email me. It's just juliew@illinois.edu, or go to our website, go.uillinois.edu/RIMS. Otherwise, I will email you this recording of the webinar, my slides, and the updated handout, hopefully by the end of the day. And we will hopefully talk to you soon at our next webinar. Thank you, everyone.